Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. Bhutan's Prime Minister has said that China must maintain status quo at the Doklam region. And he has also said that such a status quo is required in order to maintain peace and tranquility in the region. This statement has been made in the context of various reports that the People's Liberation Army of China is rapidly building up military infrastructure across the Doklam plateau. And such a rapid military build-up by China has the potential to increase tensions between India and China, and this is a reminder of the developments which took place in the year 2017. In 2017, India and China witnessed a major standoff at the Doklam region, and this dispute in 2017 had nearly brought India and China to the brink of conflict. So in this context, let us understand where Doklam is located and why is it relevant for both India and China. The Doklam plateau is also referred to as the Donglang region, and it is located in Bhutan over here. It is located at the tri-junction of India, China and Bhutan. So the Doklam plateau, which is located in Bhutan, occupies a strategic location because it oversees the Chumbi Valley of China and the Siliguri corridor of India. And this strategic location is a part of a standing border dispute between China and Bhutan. There are three locations where China and Bhutan have a standing border dispute. One of them is the Doklam plateau. The other two includes Jakarlung and Pasamlung. So if the Doklam plateau is located inside Bhutan, and if it is a part of a territorial dispute between China and Bhutan, then why is India involved in this conflict? This is the question which comes to our mind. And the answer to this question lies in the 1949 Treaty of Peace and Friendship, which was signed between India and Bhutan. According to this treaty, India agreed not to interfere in the internal affairs of Bhutan. And in return, Bhutan agreed to be guided by India in its external affairs, and India was also given the responsibility to assist Bhutan in defending its territorial integrity. So the 1949 treaty gave India a larger responsibility to assist Bhutan in its external affairs and in its defense policies. This treaty has been revised and updated in 2007, and this revised treaty has given greater independence and autonomy to Bhutan over its foreign policy and as well as over its defense policy. So due to these commitments, India has a larger responsibility to help Bhutan while dealing with Chinese aggression in the region. And along with this, India also sees the Doklam plateau as a strategic location because of its proximity to the Siliguri corridor, which is a strategic weakness for India. Because the Siliguri corridor is a narrow patch of land which connects the Indian mainland with the northeast of India. And during the 1962 conflict, the People's Liberation Army had posed a considerable challenge to India's control over the Siliguri corridor. So that's the reason why India considers the Siliguri corridor as a strategic weakness. So any aggressive developments by China in the Doklam plateau has great strategic significance for India as well. So in 2017, it was reported that the Chinese PLA had started constructing roads in the disputed area of Doklam. And this construction was immediately challenged by the Indian Army. So this challenge by the Indian Army resulted in a military standoff between India and China, and tensions started to escalate in 2017. This increase in tensions nearly brought India and China to the brink of conflict, and it was only resolved through high-level diplomatic engagement between the Indian leadership and the Chinese leadership. First, a de-escalation was achieved through the Astana consensus between the Indian Prime Minister and the Chinese President during the Astana summit of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization. Later, the two leaders again interacted during the Wuhan summit, which was an informal summit between India and China, and these two diplomatic initiatives helped both the countries to de-escalate the tensions over the Doklam crisis. Next, on page 13, The Hindu carries an interview of Bhutan's Prime Minister, wherein he talks about the various aspects of India's relations with Bhutan. First, he talks about the close relations between the two countries with regard to exploitation of Bhutan's hydropower potential. Since Bhutan is a Himalayan country, it is blessed with tremendous hydropower potential, and hydropower is clean, renewable, and sustainable. This advantage of hydropower is in line with the commitments that Bhutan has made with regard to its gross national happiness index. Bhutan has adopted a very unique model of economic development, which is not measured entirely by GDP. Instead, it is measured through gross national happiness index. This index in turn places a very high priority for sustainable development, conservation of environment, and protection of culture and tradition. So due to these commitments and its target of gross national happiness, Bhutan is very much interested in further exploiting its hydropower potential, and India is playing a very important role in providing technical and financial assistance in order to help Bhutan to exploit its hydropower potential. Over the years, India has sponsored a number of hydropower projects, and these projects have helped Bhutan to become an exporter of electricity in South Asia. One such project which has been sponsored by India has been mentioned in this interview. It refers to the Mangdechu hydropower project, which is slated to be completed very soon, and most likely Prime Minister Modi will be visiting Bhutan in a couple of months to inaugurate the Mangdechu hydropower project. Today, Bhutan is exporting sustainable and renewable hydropower to neighboring countries such as India, Nepal, and Bangladesh. And this has helped Bhutan to achieve the highest per capita income in South Asia. And in order to facilitate this export of electricity, India and Bhutan have signed an agreement known as the Cross-Border Trade in Electricity. This policy was proposed by India in 2016, but the initial proposal was opposed by Bhutan because this policy was perceived to be in favor of India and violative of Bhutan's national interests. So based on this opposition by Bhutan, India reviewed and updated this agreement, and subsequent changes were introduced into the Cross-Border Trade in Electricity Agreement in order to ensure that Bhutan is completely satisfied with the bilateral relationship. The next important aspect of the bilateral relationship is connectivity. India had proposed an ambitious project known as BBIN, and this connectivity corridor was supposed to connect Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, and Nepal with the objective of promoting regional connectivity and economic cooperation. India's idea was to provide port access to the landlocked countries of Bhutan and Nepal by helping them access the ports located in India and Bangladesh. And as a part of the BBIN corridor, India had also proposed a motor vehicles agreement to provide for free movement of vehicles and goods across the four countries. But this ambitious project of India was rejected by Bhutan's parliament because such large-scale projects goes against the core values of Bhutan's constitution, which is to promote sustainable development and conservation of environment. So on these grounds, the Bhutanese parliament had rejected the BBIN corridor, and the Prime Minister has reiterated Bhutan's commitment to environment conservation and sustainability. Next, he also talks about the relevance of SAARC, considering the fact that India has been neglecting SAARC as a part of its diplomatic strategy to isolate Pakistan through the SAARC minus Pakistan strategy. Since the Uri attacks, India has been neglecting Pakistan and isolating Pakistan in the diplomatic world. And that's the reason why SAARC has received lesser focus from India, and instead, India has been actively promoting and it is trying to revive the BIMSTEC. In this context, the Prime Minister of Bhutan has said that it is too early to consider the SAARC to be irrelevant, because SAARC as an organization has an emotional connection to all the South Asian countries. And recently, even the President of Sri Lanka and the Prime Minister of Nepal, even they have given similar calls to revive the SAARC in order to further promote regional cooperation in South Asia. So Bhutan's Prime Minister has said that SAARC will continue to function well only if India and Pakistan resolve all their issues. But until then, it is too early to write off SAARC as an irrelevant organization. Next, he talks about the Doklam dispute and the recent reports of China's military buildup at the Doklam region, this is where he has called upon China to maintain status quo and ensure that there is no recurrence of the 2017 standoff between India and China. And he also refers to the ongoing border negotiations between Bhutan and China, and he says that considerable progress has been achieved over the years to resolve the border dispute, which is present at three locations along the Bhutan-China border. And finally, he says that Bhutan has no interest to establish official diplomatic ties with China because it goes against Bhutan's policy of not establishing diplomatic ties with any of the P5 countries. This is a very interesting point that you need to note down. Bhutan has diplomatic ties with very few countries, and it has deliberately kept the P5 countries away. And the Prime Minister has said that Bhutan will not violate this policy and it will not be establishing diplomatic ties with China. Next, we have an editorial on page 10, which evaluates the recently concluded Shanghai Cooperation Organization Summit at Bishkek. While evaluating the Bishkek Summit of SCO, the editorial says that the organization has become a very important component of India's foreign policy to push forward its Eurasia policy. The SCO has emerged as a major regional organization in Eurasia, and it is primarily led by Russia and China, and it also includes various Central Asian countries such as Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan. Recently in 2017, India and Pakistan were also admitted as full-time members to the SCO, and important regional countries such as Iran and Afghanistan also enjoy the observer status at the SCO. And the recently concluded Bishkek summit has clearly shown that the SCO is focused on three major themes, which includes terrorism, regional cooperation, and the future of the Afghan peace process. So when you look at the composition of SCO and the focus areas of SCO, we can clearly say that this organization is perfectly suited for India's foreign policy in order to protect its national interests in the Eurasian region. For example, SCO provides the right platform for India and Pakistan to interact, especially over the issue of terrorism. Tensions between India and Pakistan continue to remain high, and India has refused to engage Pakistan diplomatically because of its role in sponsoring terrorism in the region. So SCO could provide one such platform where India and Pakistan could discuss issues related to terrorism, and India can make use of the RATS platform, which is set up at the SCO in order to promote cooperation in the field of counterterrorism. RATS stands for Regional Anti-Terrorist Structure, which is a dedicated platform of the SCO to promote cooperation in the field of counterterrorism, and SCO will also help India to promote regional cooperation in order to secure its energy security by securing energy assets in the Central Asian countries which are blessed with energy sources, and it will also help India to improve connectivity and trade with the Eurasian countries. Plus, the SCO can help India to take forward the Afghan peace process, because both India and SCO believe in an Afghan-led, Afghan-owned initiative in order to bring the civil war in Afghanistan to an end. Apart from these advantages, the SCO will also help India to pursue its policy of multiple alignments, because the core principle of India's foreign policy is the principle of strategic autonomy. As a part of this principle, India has retained its autonomy in foreign policy making, and it does not believe in aligning itself with any of the major power blocs. Be it US, be it Russia or China, India doesn't align with any of the power bloc. Instead, it pursues a policy of multiple alignment, which is designed to protect and promote India's national interests. In this regard, the SCO provides the right platform for India to pursue its policy of multiple alignments. Next, we have a column written by N.L. Raja on the topic of public procurement. Public procurement is nothing but the procurement of goods, material and services by a public authority or a government authority from the market. When a government procures goods, materials and services from the market, we label this as public procurement. And generally, this procurement is done on the basis of tenders which are issued. Whenever a certain material or certain services are to be procured by the government, tenders are issued and tenders are invited by the private players. And those who can provide the best quality at the lowest price will be awarded the tender. In the case of India, such public procurement through tenders accounts for 30% of India's GDP. So clearly, the government is incurring a huge expenditure in procuring public goods and services. But despite this fiscal significance, public procurement in India is not regulated by any parliamentary legislation. Till date, there is no central law which is guiding public procurement, and instead, it is regulated by a series of complicated regulations, guidelines, and rules. So this legislative vacuum, which exists with regard to public procurement, has conveniently promoted corruption with regard to issuing of tenders. It has promoted ineffectiveness, and it has even delayed the procurement of vital goods and services. So as a result, a number of petitions have been filed at the Supreme Court in order to challenge the process through which the tenders are awarded. And since there is no law which regulates the awarding of tenders, it has given a lot of discretion to the political executive and the bureaucrats, which can be easily misused to promote corrupt practices. In this context, the writer is asking the government to introduce a central legislation to regulate public procurement and provide for redressal of grievances. In the past, the UPA government had made an attempt to introduce the Public Procurement Bill in 2012, but it was not passed by the parliament. More recently, the NDA government introduced a revised version of the 2012 bill, which was known as the Public Procurement Bill of 2015. But even this proposed legislation has been hanging in the parliament. So the writer says that if corruption has to be tackled with regard to public procurement and awarding of tenders, and if effectiveness has to be brought in for procurement of public goods and services, then it is very essential that a central law needs to be passed, which will regulate public procurement and establish a grievance redressal mechanism. Next, on page 11, we have a column written by Subhash Kashyap on the topic of the leader of the opposition in the Lok Sabha. Today, the pro-term speaker who has been appointed by the president will be administering the oath to the newly elected MPs of the 17th Lok Sabha, and he will enable the house to elect a speaker for the Lok Sabha. And once the speaker of the Lok Sabha has been elected, the next task is to formally recognize an opposition party and appoint the leader of the opposition for the Lok Sabha. These formal designations have been defined under the Salary and Allowances of Leaders of Opposition in Parliament Act of 1977. This legislation lays down the basic criteria which is required to formally designate an opposition party in the Lok Sabha and appoint a leader of the opposition for the Lok Sabha. According to the basic criteria which has been laid out in the 1977 legislation, the leader of the largest party in opposition can be recognized as the leader of opposition for the Lok Sabha, provided if that party has enough strength in the Lok Sabha to constitute quorum for a sitting house. Quorum is nothing but the minimum number of members required to carry out the proceedings of the house. So the leader of the largest opposition party in Lok Sabha can be appointed as the leader of the opposition, provided if the party has quorum to conduct the house, or if it has 1/10 of the total membership of the house. So currently, this minimum number stands at 55 members. Basically, if a party has more than 55 members, then the leader of that party can be appointed as the leader of the opposition. According to the 1977 legislation, the leader of the opposition will be given the cabinet rank. He will enjoy the same emoluments and perks as that of a cabinet minister. And as the leader of the opposition, he can lead the opposition party and play a very important role in ensuring the health and success of a democracy. Because the opposition party is very much needed in order to keep a check on the activities of the government and ensure that the government and the executive is held accountable to the parliament. So having an effective opposition, which is headed by a leader of the opposition, is an absolute must to ensure the success and survival of a democracy. But there have been a few Lok Sabhas wherein we did not have a leader of the opposition. There was no opposition party which was formally recognized as the opposition party. In a few Lok Sabhas, the opposition parties have failed to get the minimum numbers which are needed, that is more than 55 members, in order to be formally recognized as the opposition party and the leader to be appointed as the leader of the opposition in the Lok Sabha. Most recently, this happened during the 16th Lok Sabha because the Congress, which was the largest opposition party in the Lok Sabha, had a strength of 44 members. This is clearly short of the criteria, and as a result, the previous Speaker of the Lok Sabha did not appoint a leader of the opposition and did not designate the Congress party as the official opposition party in the Lok Sabha. In this context, the writer says that the absence of a formal opposition party in the Lok Sabha and the vacant office of the leader of the opposition represents a major threat for India's democracy. In this context, the writer is asking the new Lok Sabha speaker who will be elected today to exercise his discretion, which has been provided under the 1977 legislation. Because this legislation only lays down a basic minimum criteria for the appointment of the leader of the opposition. The minimum criteria of 55 members is not a mandatory criteria which has been laid out by the 1977 legislation. It is not an essential prerequisite. Instead, it is just a basic minimum criteria, and hence the speaker enjoys a certain discretion over here when it comes to the appointment of the leader of the opposition and designation of an opposition party as the formal opposition party. Because if you look at the constitution of India and the rules of the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha, they do not talk about the opposition party and the leader of the opposition. These designations have been defined through the 1977 legislation, which provided for salary and allowances of leaders of opposition in parliament, and it only laid out a minimum criteria of 55 members, and this cannot be considered as an essential prerequisite. So basically, the Speaker of the Lok Sabha enjoys a certain discretion over here, and the writer is asking the new Lok Sabha Speaker to exercise his discretion and appoint a leader of the opposition in the larger interest of India's democracy. And in order to make this happen, the writer suggests that the speaker can consider the leader of the largest pre-poll alliance to be appointed as the leader of the opposition, because right now in the 17th Lok Sabha, the largest opposition party is again the Congress, but it only has a strength of 52 members in the House. The Congress party on its own still falls short of the 55 members which are needed, but since this is not an essential prerequisite, the speaker can exercise his discretion and overlook the criteria, and instead of appointing the leader of the largest opposition party, he can choose to appoint the leader of the largest pre-poll alliance as the leader of the opposition by keeping in mind the larger interests of India's democracy. Now let's take up the practice questions. Which of the following statements are correct? Encephalitis can be caused by viruses such as herpes simplex virus and rabies virus, and as well as by bacteria, fungi or parasites. In India, acute encephalitis outbreaks in North and Eastern India have been linked to children eating unripe lychee fruits on empty stomachs. Both the statements are correct, so option C is the correct answer. Now let's take up the second question. Which of the following statements are correct? If a cyclone abruptly changes direction and moves in the opposite direction, then it is referred to as a recurving cyclone. Cyclone Okchi was a recurving cyclone. Both the statements are correct. Option C is the correct answer. Now let's take up the third question. Resource efficiency dialogue, which deals with waste management, is a part of which summit? The correct answer is option A, the G20 summit. Now let's take up a map-based question. Which of the following passes connects Sikkim with Chumbi Valley? The correct answer is option C, both 1 and 2. that is both Nathula and Jeleplla passes, they connect Sikkim with Chumbi Valley. Let us look at the map over here. The Chumbi Valley is located in China at the tri-junction of India, China and Bhutan. You can see that Sikkim is located over here. And the two passes which connect Sikkim with the Chumbi Valley are the Nathula Pass and the Jeleplla Pass. Now let's take up a question from the 2017 prelims paper. Which one of the following statements is correct? If you go through the four statements, we can say that option C is the correct statement. Rights are claims of the citizens against the state. Finally, let's take up a mains practice question. Discuss the salient aspects of India-Bhutan relationship and evaluate the impact of Bhutan's border dispute with China on its ties with India. We have already had an elaborate discussion on this topic, so I would expect you to write an answer and post your answers in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.